Very good morning. I had a friend, a very senior, respected gentleman. He was an IAS officer. He had a house in Bangalore. He belonged to Bangalore. Then he got posted out to different places and he spent most of his working life outside Bangalore. And finally, he retired and he came back. He started doing up his house and, you know, setting it right and things of that sort. Tenants were there since a long time. So he was trying to make it, you know, more suitable to his own living, because that's now going to be his permanent house. In the small setback area on the side of his house, he had planted a tree long back. And that tree had grown quite big. It was giving shade. It was nice green. And, you know, it used to cool down the place and nice breeze used to come. All that was happening. But slowly he started noticing that the tree's roots are causing a crack. First in the compound wall, then even in the building. So the foundation of the building and the wall, he started seeing small little crack developing and, you know, increasing. He kept wondering what to do. He liked the tree. He didn't want to cut down the tree. So for a long time, he was thinking, what do I do? But then what do you do? The tree is, you know, you can't tell the tree, don't expand your roots in this direction or something of that sort. The tree doesn't listen to you. Tree is not like a pet that you can give instructions to, right? So months went past. In fact, 1 year, 2 years went past. And then he realized that, no, these cracks are getting very bad. Now, that was a time, I'm talking about the good old days, when Bangalore still was quite strict about cutting down trees. So you had to take permission from the authorities before you cut down a tree, even if it was in your own compound. This gentleman was a retired IAS officer, influential person, and this and that, and he thought, my house is in a by lane, nobody will even notice. So one fine day on a Sunday, he got some labor. And he chopped down the tree and removed all the wood and everything. And he thought nothing will happen. Promptly the next day, the fellow in charge of the municipal corporation, you know, the sweeping, cleaning of that road, he came and rang his bell. And he said, sir, there used to be a tree here and that tree has disappeared. And this man pulled up all his dignity and height and he said, yes, I know about it. I also love trees. I never, I'm in favor of cutting down trees and things of that sort. But, you know, this particular tree, how it was affecting this and it was, you know, creating these cracks in the foundations and my building would have suffered. And I waited for 2-3 years to see if by chance it can be set right or something. Then I realized that, no, it's getting worse and worse and the cracks are going to get bad. So after years of waiting and all that, I finally decided that nothing can be done. So I've chopped it off. No big deal. Okay, you can go. The man looked at him, he realized that, yes, he's an influential elderly person. He can't probably, you know, try to take any action against him or something. So he said, yes, sir, I agree with you. Maybe you had to do that. But 3 years back when you realized that possibly you may have to cut down this tree, if you could have planted another tree a little away from there, which will not hurt your foundation, by now, that tree would have been 3 years old and would have been giving us some shade and greenery. And he said that and he went away. This man absolutely felt like a fool. And he was recounting this to me. He was, you know, broad-minded enough to tell me that, see, sometimes here I am, supposedly one of the top officials and I know everything type of thing. And here was another government employee who was right at the rock bottom of the hierarchy. And he had more wisdom than me in some simple matters which are directly connected to our environment and nature and things of that sort. That is what I would like you to please give a serious thought to. Nobody can deny the fact that the other aspects of nature, the flora and fauna, as we call it, the trees, the fishes, the animals, the insects, all these people came much before human beings. We are intruders into this world called the earth. Before us, we had all these people happily prospering. Even a few generations back, when we didn't have these mega cities and big highways and, you know, trains and planes and things of that sort. Even at that time, human beings used to occupy small portions here and there with a lot of space, lot of, you know, adjustment towards nature. So people had bungalows which had a lot of open space and some trees, and on those trees the, you know, the birds used to come and build their nests. There would be stray animals, some dog, some cat would come and hang around in the compound. So even in cities, 2-3 generations back, people did live in harmony. Most people had animals in their houses and most people grew trees and all that. Now we say that compulsion, space has become less. So we start building skyscrapers. We start locking ourselves into our 2 BHK, 3 BHK, and those sort of things. For a huge building complex, we make one small park and we say this is children's park and children can come here and play within this 50 feet, 100 feet, whatever it is, and the rest of it is all concrete jungle. And this, unfortunately, is also spreading to the rural areas. The effect of the urban thinking is slowly catching up with rural areas. I still remember maybe 20 years, 30 years back when I used to, you know, visit villages, the mindset of the villager was totally different from what it is today. Particularly, I'm talking about villagers who have some connection. They are either on the highway or they are near a city or town, or some they have some commercial activity. Even they are losing the touch with nature, which a typical villager always traditionally used to have. People were told to respect ecology. Children were brought up to say that we have to literally worship every living being. We have to respect, we have to adapt to them. But have we done that? We didn't. And the funny part of it is that it is not even because of our capabilities. Human being, minus all his paraphernalia and his add-ons, cannot survive in the jungle. Can you visualize if somebody just gives you some food for 1 week and nothing else, and sends you in the middle of a jungle which is surrounded with all sorts of wild animals? Do you really think you can survive there? There are these animals survive beautifully. They have nothing, no issues at all, neither mentally nor about fear nor about where their next food is going to come from, where they are going to defecate. Everything that's taken care of, but we can't do it. We are such vulnerable, we are such pitiable creatures. So how did we become so superior that today nature is, you know, subservient to us? We are dictating terms. We are chopping down trees and jungles. We are killing animals left, right, and center. How did we get that authority or that power in our hands? Sorry to say, we got it through cunning. We got it through crafty means. We didn't do it the typical way an animal of the jungle does. An animal of the jungle faces the enemy, knowing fully well that I can get eliminated if the enemy is stronger than me. But we don't do that. We have done it in a very crafty way. And today, a simple thing, for example, if you take, no animal kills another animal, even what we call as the carnivorous animals, you know, animals who are non-vegetarian, who eat other animals for their food. Even those animals kill another animal when they are hungry and they want food, because their metabolism is such that they are not herbivorous, they are not vegetarian, they are carnivorous. They like, they enjoy, and they thrive on what we refer to as non-vegetarian food, that is the flesh of other animals. But they kill only for their immediate need. Even a massive animal like a tiger or a lion, who's got the strength to kill as many of the deers and rabbits and all other smaller animals that he can, he kills, let's say, a tiger kills a deer because he's hungry. And he tears open that deer's body and starts eating the flesh. when his stomach is full, he just leaves the rest of the carcass and goes into some corner and is dozing. Now some foxes or jackals or smaller animals come and they see this dead body and a lot of flesh is there and they start eating. The tiger can go and swoop over them and kill them in one shot, but he doesn't do it. He's relaxed. He says, okay, let them enjoy themselves. I've had my fill. He doesn't say that, no, I have to cut up the rest of the animal and put it in deep freezer so that tomorrow when I feel hungry, I will take it out and put it in a microwave and eat it, something of that sort. No, he's least bothered about where his meal the next day is going to come from. But human beings are the only species which kill either animals or plants or trees without even having the need of filling up their stomach. This is something that I want us to even, you know, work on. We also have one very funny system of looking at nature. We go more by what is useful to us. If I ask people, give me the name of one species which has got some intrinsic good qualities in it, they immediately start saying things like dog, cat, cow. Why? Because we benefit from them. Nobody mentions ants, who's got fantastic abilities. In many ways, believe me, I think ants are superior to human beings, including at the emotional level. Nobody mentions cockroaches. What amazing qualities that cockroaches got. I won't take your time to, you know, list it out, but you can check it out. Why? Because we don't like them. They don't look good to us. They're not nice to us. We don't benefit. They don't come wagging their tail behind us like the dog does. We are such selfish people. But in being selfish, what are we achieving? Let me quickly read out to you what happened in the year 1854. That's a long, long way back, right? The white man, that is the Europeans, had come to USA and slowly they had started expanding. They had started putting up their ranches and farms and towns and this and that. Now there were already a race of people existing there who today we call as Red Indians. They were the natives of the North Indian, North American peninsula, the continent, from generations, maybe from thousands of years. And they were being pushed down by these people. Finally, the day came when the president of USA in the year 1854 sent a message to the biggest chief of the Red Indians, who was the most influential among the Red Indian tribes, telling him, you can't beat us. We have got guns, cannons, these, that. We can wipe you out. So better surrender to us and we'll provide you with some restricted reservations. Some areas we'll mark out and you go and live there and the rest of the land we will take over. For what joy? He had no justification except that he had the power to do it. He could physically kill and eliminate these people and take over. Now the Red Indian chief obviously was an unlettered man. A man who had no education, no wisdom, no great administrative skills or anything of that sort. But you know what he replied to the president of the American government? He said, how can you buy or sell the sky, the warmth of the land? The idea is strange to us. If we do not own the freshness of the air and sparkle of the water, how can you buy them? Every part of this earth is sacred to my people, he said. Every shining pine needle, every sandy shore, every mist in the dark woods, every humming insect is holy in the memory and experience of my people. The white man's dead forget the country of their birth when they go to walk among the stars. We are part of the earth and it is part of us. The perfume flowers are our sisters. The deer, the horse, the great eagle, these are our brothers. So, and the great chief of Washington, that is the president of USA, sends word that he wishes to buy our land, he asks much of us. I'm cutting it short to tell you that the Red Indian chief then said, the whites too shall pass, perhaps sooner than all the other tribes. Contaminate your bed and you will one night suffocate in your own waste. That destiny is a mystery to us, for we do not understand. When the buffaloes are all slaughtered, the wild horses are tamed, the secret corners of the forest heavy with scent of many men, and the view of ripe hills blotted by talking wires, that is the telegraph lines. Where is the thicket? Gone. Where is the eagle? Gone. The end of living and the beginning of survival. 200 years back, this is what the Red Indian chief told us. And believe me, if we have not come so far to the end of living and beginning of survival, we are just on the precipice. We have come very close to it. This is my request to each one of you, that when nature can take care of itself, when all living beings can live in harmony, why is it that we cannot connect to nature? There are 6-7 billion human beings in this world. There are 1.3 trillion fishes alone. Only one species I'm talking about. And the only time when we look at fish, the only thought that comes to our mind is, will this make a good pomfret? Or can I have fish and chips or fish fingers or whatever it is? Can we not look at the balance of ecology? It is not at all difficult. Everywhere around you, this is what is happening. Now, this is not restricted to all those big things, like, you know, people say, what can I do if the Western Ghats are being encroached upon? Who am I as an ordinary citizen? Look at just the thing around you. Okay, I also live in a concrete jungle called Bengaluru. All around me are, you know, houses and these and structures and, you know, tar roads and cement roads and all these type of things. But whenever I get an opportunity, I'm fascinated. Let me just show you what I saw yesterday when I was walking into the office. Have a look at this little clip and you will be amazed at what I saw. Here is our office. These are the two trees that we have planted in front of the office, and we keep very, you know, closely monitoring them so that nobody comes and cuts them off. Now, in front of the office, when you want to enter over there, is this metal gate, a small metal gate. We lock it up in the night and we open it. But yesterday when I was coming, I peered closely at the bottom of this gate. And do you see what I see here? There's a plant growing out of the metal. A metal gate made out of iron pipes. And from there, this living being is sprouting out. Where did it come from? Where are the seeds coming from? Where is the soil for its roots? Who is taking care of them? Who is the gardener who made this? But there it is, ladies and gentlemen. Nature at your doorstep. You don't have to go miles into the open area and the jungles to see nature. If you are open to it, nature comes to you. You just have to welcome it with open arms. Whatever the season, whether it is summer or winter or monsoon, welcome nature and you will find that there is so much. The way your life can be enriched. If you see the banner behind me, we say, enriching life through empowerment. We do not restrict that empowerment to human beings. Let us empower every living being. From the tiniest of insects and microbes and even coronavirus. Okay, coronavirus has its own reason why she keeps coming and biting us and all that, but it also has its own, you know, reasons for survival, isn't it? That is how we need to look at things. So I'm going to, in few minutes, pass you on to my friends who have already reached Manthan. I'm also going to join them a little later. We are having this Manthan camp. And we have some of my friends who have already reached there. And they are enjoying the nature. Even that little 6 acres of open land, which we are jealously protecting without allowing them trees to be cut down or the greenery to be eliminated. So before I hand you over to them and they will share with you what they are experiencing in nature, do I have any questions or do I have any nice wise comments which I can take back with me? The chat box is open. Please type in whatever you want. I really want to see your responses, your reactions, not only to what I have said, but what are the thoughts in your mind when we talk about nature? There are so many of you, I'm sure, who have had excellent experiences. Is there anybody who wants to share with us or even ask questions or doubts about what further you would like to know and how things are? Please put it in the chat box. Please also focus on conservation. That's another area of neglect, particularly in the urban areas. If you are using water, just because water flows freely in your tap, please do not misuse it. Do not waste even 1 liter of water in the whole day. If you're using electricity, it comes from natural sources. You're well aware of that. Please do not use more electricity than what you actually need. Please ensure that anything and everything that you are taking from nature, you give back. As I gave you the example right in the beginning, if you feel that a tree needs to be cut, please plant 2 trees first and then cut this tree when you feel that it is absolutely necessary. Don't pass the buck by saying that the government or the authorities or those people have to take care of nature and all these type of things. You don't even have a compound. You live in an apartment. You probably have a balcony. Have some nature coming into your balcony. Amit says the ancient ways of life, the houses were built, had a science which we have not understood and imbibed the West. Yes, Amit, I 100% agree with you. I have so much to say because I've also been in the world of constructions and projects and all that. So I have so much to share if anybody is willing to listen to us. Whenever somebody is making a house or doing something, I try to put in my 2 bits worth. Some people do listen to me. A lot of people don't. But it is a fact of what Amit said just now. In whatever way, even for example, when you are constructing a house, see how much of nature what you are doing. I had a friend of mine who wanted to make a house in a plot where there was this huge and lovely tree. I managed to sit with the architect and we designed a house without cutting down the tree. The tree was right inside the house. It is possible. Surekha says the oyster makes a pearl from a painful grain of sand that agonizes it. Yes. What could we not create if we reached positively to those things that get under our skin? Absolutely right, Surekha. There is so much that we can do if we just have that little empathy. Next time you see a stream of ants, please observe them carefully. Look at the way they interact with each other. Look at their sense of duty. Look at their teamwork. Tulsi says, nature do affect us in many ways, mental and healthy living. Yes, I'm glad you brought up this. Our mental health improves, you know, if we are in harmony with nature. The more we isolate ourselves in concrete jungles, the greater is your chance that mental health is going to go down. Sonia says, be careful for everything. A cut tree will be standing again if it's rooted well in Mother Earth. We can stand again if life's difficulties break us down. And that's what my learning from nature. We will bloom again when the time comes. Be patient and keep trying to stand up again. I would even extend it to say, if you cannot stand up, then at least sit properly, crawl, take a walking stick and walk if necessary, but do not stop. life always goes on. We need to know that life is far beyond any individual human being. It's far beyond your, you know, individual needs. People build houses to last for 100, 200 years. They keep telling that I want a very strong structure. I want strong foundation. I want pillars. I want this. I want, you know, so much of concrete and this and that. But they forget that houses convert into homes only through living beings. Those of you who are fond of animals or pets, you will know when you come back home after a tiring time outside the house, whoever in your family may welcome you and smile at you, but your pet comes running to you. The pet is one person who gives you this unconditional love. And let us not restrict ourselves to pet. Nature is far beyond our pets. Our pets are serving our purpose, and that's why we love them and take care of them. Let's also take care of those who are not our pets, from whom we are not getting anything directly. You're all aware of the fact that the more trees we have, the more oxygen we have. And oxygen not only is our source of livelihood, but better oxygen also strengthens our minds, and our mental health and our mental energy increases if we are having ample oxygen. These are the small things which make a difference. We don't realize it directly, indirectly, how this is happening, how trees affect us, how other animals, the ecology, how things change when the things are there. There's this friend of mine who has a farm next to Mantan. Whenever some villagers nearby say that there is a snake, he catches the snake and brings it into his farm. He explains in depth how the ecology benefits by having snakes in his farm. Varnika says we need to ground ourselves in nature. Very right. That's a wonderful word you have used, ground ourselves in nature. Nowadays, there's no ground available to dig our feet into. And even if there is ground, probably it has been laid with concrete, so we'll only hurt our feet if we try to dig ourselves in, isn't it? Very, very, significant and very important things. And with that, I thought today when we are talking about nature, we should do it amidst nature. So I have requested Meera and her team who are there to get a few people from different walks of life, different experiences of life, to share with you while they are in amidst nature in Manthan about what nature can do for us, how nature affects us, the benefits of nature, and how we can give back to nature, not from an altruistic or charitable point of view, but from the point of view of maintaining that balance because of which we get back so much that we can get from nature. That is what I want you to please understand. And with all my good wishes to all of you, I'm passing you on to Manthan, and I will look forward to meeting you again next Saturday when we are going to talk about how do you look forward to 2021. There have been innumerable debates about what 2020 has done to us, but whatever it is, as they said, as we were saying a few minutes back, that everything passes, everything changes. So 2020, whether we like it or not, moves into 2021. Next Saturday, we will discuss whether you are looking forward to it, whether you are scared of it, whether you have doubts and apprehensions, what could be the good things, what could be the bad things. Let's prepare ourselves next Saturday at 11 o'clock in the same series of programs. So over to the beautiful Manthan.
Hello, good morning, Ali.
Good morning.
We are here amidst nature.
Wonderful.
And we enjoyed your talk. It was very, very insightful. So here at Manthan today, we are spending our whole day. And we have a few people who have some experience or some learning from nature. So this is Shireen.
Hello.
Hi, Shireen.
Hi, 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 Mira.
So, I would just like to know that if you have some experience or some learning from Manthan, from nature.
Yeah, you asked me this right here amidst nature. Actually, to learn from nature, you don't need only a wild forest or an exotic garden or anything. A beautiful place like this, or any nook that you may have created in your own home where you can sit and talk about nature and what it teaches us. The main thing it teaches us is to be joyful, enjoy yourself, and also be satisfied and have peace. So you can create all this within your own self. That is very important. And another thing it teaches us is patience. This patience is so important in life, especially in today's technology driven world, that we give a very little time for things to happen. Like Kabir Das said, "Dhire dhire re mana, dhire sab kuch hoye. Mali siche sau ghare, ritu aaye phal hoye." So wait for the fruit of whatever you have. That's one thing. Then there are other things like the trees. They give us so much, and they teach us to give to people, to give to things, to give to animals, and everything in nature teaches us to give. That's basically what they.
See, however much we advance in technology, there are always hiccups, right? So somewhere we got cut off. But they will come back very soon. Yes.
So the sun, it's always there. It teaches us discipline. It teaches us that there is a time to work and there's a time to rest. And this is very important in the present day when everything, night has become day, day has become night, people work in the night and sleep during the day, which is causing a lot of stress and ill health to people. Then there are other things also which happen in nature. Just see the water, like in streams, in rivers, in oceans, wherever it is. It is shapeless, it is formless. It teaches us to persevere, overcome all obstacles, and move on in life so that we achieve whatever we want in spite of all the obstacles which come in our way. Then I would like to, that's all I would like to speak about nature today. I think I've said enough of what it has shown, given us, and I would like to end with William Wordsworth's "And then my heart with pleasure fills and dances with the daffodils." I like poets because they express everything about nature or whatever it be in a very nice way. So this is what I would. This is what I think about nature and what I feel about it.
Thank you so much, and thank you for that lovely poem and those lovely words. So
Thank you,
now,
Mia.
we have with us Mr. Rao, who's also had very close association with nature, and he's here to talk to us about a few things that he learned from nature.
Thank you, Mira. I am an agriculture scientist. I was fascinated with agriculture because I love plants. I love nature. Agriculture is a part of nature, actually. It is not separately, separate from the nature. It is a part of nature. But agriculture is a basis for the civilizations and also the cultures in the whole world, actually. See the lovely paddy gardens, paddy fields. Actually, when we see green fields, And then the blooming, you know, wonderful, you know, miracle gardens, actually, where the flowers are blooming. Not only in you know, Dubai, and when we go to the tulip gardens in Kashmir and also in Netherlands, we see that they bring such a joy and ecstasy. And to be, you know, just to say a lighter side, agriculture also teaches us agriculture, A-G-R-A-E, agriculture, which is the basis for our, you know, interpersonal relationships and a peaceful and harmonious life, actually, agriculture. But, you know, when I talk about agriculture, people think that actually it is only about the plants and the crops, fruits and vegetables. Actually, it's much more than that, actually. You know, we talk about sericulture. Sericulture industry actually is responsible for the silk industry, silk saris which we wear. And we talk about pisciculture. Pisciculture and aquaculture, it provides us the fish. And we talk about dairy, poultry. And this is all about agriculture, animal husbandry. Agriculture is not only about the plants and all. So two things which fascinated me in agriculture, I should tell you that actually one is the insect world. Other one is, microbial world. Insect world, actually, when you talk about insect world, we all think actually insects are just very minute and then nothing, great actually. But you know, in agriculture, in the whole nature, insects constitute actually around 90%, 80 to 90% of the human, the various species actually, various species of the world, in the whole creatures actually. So 80% of the, world species actually are the insects. There are 900,000 species of different types of insects. See, when I talk about insects, actually, I'm fascinated because when I see the insect larva becoming pupa, then becoming a wonderful, free butterfly, we all need to go through, transformations, meaningful transformations, so that we'll be able to really, lead a meaningful and a joyful life. When we talk about the pupal period, a difficult period, a period of training ourselves with the morals, ethics, and then the, all the, things which are required, actually. When we go through this pupal period, we come out, actually, out of freedom and we live like butterflies. Actually, that is the basis, when we see, we learn from the, this particular nature, particularly from the insects. When I talk about the microbial world, Mira, microbial world, actually, particularly in soil, the soil, we think it's a dust. It's not a dust. It's actually a living body, a dynamic living organism, we say, actually. We define, actually, soil, actually, as a living, a dynamic organism, pulsating with the billions and trillions of microorganisms, which we do not know. We only think it's a dust, but it's the basis, actually, for the agriculture. The microbials, all of them are highly beneficial. They are good enough, actually, to provide the nutrients and, so that the plants will produce fruits and vegetables and all other food grains abundantly. They are good enough, actually. And these microbials, actually, are also able to kill the insects and the fungus and bacteria. We do not need extraneous intervention, actually, of the chemical pesticides. But, we do not understand the nature in totality. And we thought that, actually, we should, out of greed, we should produce more and more. And then the whole, the industry, we have created a havoc, actually, by applying the chemical pesticides. And we have reduced the beneficial microflora to such an extent that we have invited, actually, hazardous consequences on the human life and also the environment. So that is the reason, actually, we are having, all sorts of problems. Residue-free produce, actually, is not being produced in this country. But the microbials, which are available throughout the country, throughout the nature, throughout the world, and in the soil, are to be preserved, sustained, so that the human culture and the human, civilizations will sustain. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rao. Thank you for that. And now we'll go over to Seema, who will talk to Kavyashree and Shruti. And we'll see what they have to say.
Hi, thanks, Meera. We are having fun in Manthan. It is such a serene, beautiful place. And luckily, today we are here for our 54th Manthan. A day packed with nature and the topic being self-love. And here I have two lovely ladies, Kavya and Shruti, to tell you. They're both nature lovers. I just got them from there and said, come on, you have to speak to our viewers about what you think about nature. So here we have the two gorgeous ladies.
Hi. Hello. Hi.
So, girls, what do you learn from nature?
Yeah. Hi. My name is Shruti. As Seema said, we both are nature lovers. Being an avid trekker, something which I have learned from nature is endurance, the power to not give up, that push that we need to always give ourselves when the situation, when life gets tough. Because when you're climbing the toughest mountains, you feel like giving up, but you know the view on the top is really breathtaking, that it's worth every step that you take, that it's worth every sweat that you're breaking. So this is something I've really personally learned in life, that no matter how tough life keeps going, you never give up. You've got to fight it, you've got to like keep on going for it, and you know, there's sunshine at the end of the darkest days. Yeah,
Kavya.
Yeah, so I feel that nature is the beautiful gift that we have all received, because it definitely has that healing power. It can heal a person mentally, emotionally, you know, physically and spiritually. And it teaches us in each and every day of our lives. Like, you know, let's consider the smallest things, you know, like a flower, you know, blooming, or a butterfly flying, or the morning dew, you know, or the cold breeze. So these might be the smallest things, right? But when we are seeing this, we are joyful, we are happy. So don't you guys think that even in our lives, there are all these smallest of things which we don't notice, but yet they are so helpful to us, yet they are adding so much meaning to our life. And nature clearly tells that, yes, these are the smallest things. You have to appreciate them. You have to be grateful for what you have. So I think this is a great lesson, to be content with what we have and to be grateful for what we have.
Yeah, such a beautiful topic. Another beautiful realization that I get, especially when we get flowers, is that every flower has beauty, right? The color, the petals, you know, the sizes, and also the pollen grains. If you really see them closely, how symmetrically they're all arranged so beautifully. I mean, it shows that every flower has its own uniqueness. So similarly, when we look at humans, every so we got to respect it, and we got to accept everyone's whatever they are getting, we accept it, grateful for what they are. Don't you think, Kavya, that every human being brings in their own energy? They have their own uniqueness to bring to the world, and that's exactly what makes this world a beautiful place. If we were all alive, if we had the same thing, so I think that's another really nice realization that I have, that every person is unique, is different, and we got to respect it, and that's what makes it.
Very well said, Shruti. That's absolutely right. And also, thinking of this, I just realized that, don't you think that nature has its own pace? Like, everything is going smoothly and nothing is in hurry. And whereas we are always in hurry, right? You know, we want to do things faster. We want to reach there. And we have all this, you know, goal set, you know, okay, I reach here. Then I have this. So while we are trying to reach our goals, or, you know, trying to get things done faster, we are actually not enjoying this journey, right? We are always, you know, thinking so much, and we are losing that calmness or the peace. So I think this is also a great lesson that nature tells you, that, you know, go with the flow. There's nothing to, you know, rush. You will reach your destination, but enjoy while you're going.
I think of seasons. We have, yes, like different seasons. They have their own time set. They're not in hurry, right? Like, you won't get you know, winters just right after summer. They have their own pace and their own time. So as you said, yeah, and that, you know, just be where you are. Wherever you are in life, instead of rushing. Yeah. That brings me to this yellow laddu, the sun. For me, sun is more than just the star. You know, I almost worship sun. Just look at it. It doesn't ask for anything. It doesn't demand anything.
Yeah.
It just is there, shining brightly, nourishing everything on the planet. The flowers, the everything nourished from the sun, right? Yeah. From our body. That's doesn't ask for anything. Don't you think that there's something called selflessness that we can learn from nature, that they're just there doing that, not expecting anything in return from us?
So as you mentioned, it's not just the sun, like, you know, if we see that they are there and they're giving us, you know, the sun, and the water is flowing, and, you know, without water, we cannot survive. So like that, if we go on, you know, recognize there is everything which is given to us freely. And there is, this is nothing but the selflessness that, you know, life itself is giving us. But this can be, you know, this can be considered like how even humans can be, you know, selfless. And wherever it is possible, you know, to be kind to other people, you know, to help them and to, you know, take these lessons into our life and adopt it. I think it's a great point.
And also, there's another unique way of what I see called stones and mud and the simple things, which are not so beautiful. They're not like exquisite, but they're there. Like, the stones, the sand, the mud, you know, the rocks, they're not like very flashy, they're not so beautiful, but they add their own. If we remove them, the beauty is gone. It's, nature is no more beautiful than what it is. All those trivial things which doesn't seem very flashy, which doesn't seem so grandiose, they also have their own beauty. Basically. So when I look at humans in this aspect, a person may not be a celebrity, they may not be a footballer, they may not be a great personality, but still, a very normal human being also adds their own unique energy to the world. And that is something which I really, wish everybody looks things like this, that every little thing, even the sand, the stone, the not so flashy things still have their own beauty. They still have their own uniqueness to add to the nature.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. So I think nature teaches us so many things. I mean, if we start, you know, thinking about it, you find so many examples.
Also healing. Yeah. Nature is so healing.
Correct.
You just sit calmly, just hear the birds chirping, the rivers flowing. I mean, the calming, the soothing effect of nature is unparalleled.
Correct.
Like, if you want,
yeah, for me, definitely. See, every day, like, I know I have this IT job, so it definitely, you know, stresses me out. So the last thing I do is, you know, go to terrace and then look at the sunset and the sky and the clouds. Suddenly, within no time, right, there is this calmness, you know, like everything is subtle, everything is clear. And the joy is something that we cannot get, you know, from other things. Yeah. So definitely, you know, nature, oh my God, you know, there's so much to talk about it. But yeah, so I think we can learn a lot, you know, to be calm, to find our peace, and to be selfless, and to love, and to be grateful for all that nature has given us. Thank you.
Oh my God, those were really amazing views. And go girls, I think you can enjoy your Manthan camp now. And over to Meera and with the mother and daughter there, who will be again talking about what they learned from nature. Thank you.
Yes, hi. So now you heard Kavya and Shruti, and they gave us such amazing insights into what they have learned from nature. But now we have a mom and a daughter here who are also going to talk to us about what they experience and learn from nature.
Hi everyone, this is Gia.
She's my mother and I'm 10 years old, and today I want to share my views about nature. And according to me, I feel nature is art. Like, whenever I see nature, I see trees, mountains, rivers, and nature also teaches me color combinations and the birds chirping, the music, and nature is just fantastic.
Like Gia said, yes, in every action, whatever is happens in nature, it gives a message. There is a silent learning which we have to observe and learn. So what I have learned is, like, nature teaches us to be an interdependent. Nothing is, we can say, independent or dependent. There is an interdependent thing, and that leads to the point of responsibility, how responsibly we are acting, so that interdependent thing will work. So responsibility, the child who is taking a birth is also contributing something to nature. What? The carbon dioxide. A child also contributes to the carbon dioxide, and the moment it starts growing, the responsibility increases. And if we don't act responsibly, then the balance goes down. Sometimes, like many things, like we know, happens if nature loses its balance. So the balance is very important, and that teaches me if, like, we also have to learn from nature. If we are losing our balance, then how it affects. So I'm learning from nature. One thing is that to be balanced. And if it is disturbing or something is not working fine, then nature also reacts to that. It disturbs the things and again maintains its balance. So that is what a big thing which I have learned from the nature.
Can I add something?
Of course.
Like, also nature teaches us not to give up, because if we cut the nature's branches, so then the nature again, like, the branch grows. That's all. Thank you.
And here, like, nature teaches us, like, it gives us a space for the manthan. So this is, I'm very happy to be in the nature's place where I have that space for myself to do the manthan, how to grow, where, what, and how I can contribute, how can I be responsible for myself and love myself, because I'm learning that from nature. Nature also loves first themselves. If you are disturbing, it destroys, and then it again stands. So that's how I'm also learning how to stand from nature. And here I am in a beautiful place called Banjara Manthan Camp. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And as you all can see, we are amidst nature, and there are beautiful flowers growing here. And it is so amazing, like how Shireen said that, you know, heart dances with the daffodils. Our heart and soul is also dancing over here. So with all the beautiful flowers, these are all the lovely people who spoke to us today. And there is Seema here. And we are all going to have fun. So,
guys, I'm feeling so jealous of you guys.
I can't see you. You can meet your
MP line. I'm down right away, and I'm going to come there.
Yeah, because enjoy the we will show movie. Everyone what we are in. And we are really, and we have so many things here. And today, whole day, we are going to spend with nature, and we are going to learn how to love ourselves. So that's, here we are at Manthan.
The green itself is so cool, to cooling to the eyes, actually.
Yes. Seema, would you like to say something?
Yeah, so these are just a few of us. There are 50 or more, you know, all over the place. It's a huge place. So we're all enjoying amidst nature and beauty and having a wonderful day. And the whole day we are going to be spending here. So we are waiting for Ali and Sunita to join us soon. And next time, you know, we would want many of you also to join us here. So it's going to be really good. So,
okay. Yeah, so, right. Yeah. So that's by here at Manthan. We are.
Thank you so much, guys. Thank you for sharing those lovely nature views and all those wonderful words from all of our students and, you know, friends. Bye. See you. Thank you so much.
Bye.
Bye. Have a lovely day. I'll be there in half an hour. Okay.
Yeah.
Come. For you. All right. See you. Bye-bye.
Right, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us on this wonderful Saturday. You know, don't miss this weekend. Start immediately. Be it a plant in your balcony, or, you know, taking a short trip to a nearby nature place. Do go and ground yourself, get in touch, get back to the basics, get back to nature, and enjoy your lives with the lovely learnings from nature. Okay, see you again next Saturday. Bye-bye.